So welcome to our final virtual Humanities Happy Hour before we break for the summer. Thanks so much for joining us. Today we have Dylan Dwyer talking about the history of the saxophone and how it relates to American culture. And with that, I'm going to give it to you, Dylan.
Thanks, Sam. I want to thank Humanities Montana for letting me have this opportunity to nerd out about the saxophone with you all. I've had a really, really great time over the past few months traveling around the state before, when I was able to, going to a lot of different schools and giving this presentation. And it's been refined over the past couple of months, so I hope you enjoy it. It's called Reviled or Revered, The Role of Saxophone in History, Media, Society, and Culture. So here's the fun part. You can use your chat to answer the first question, which is just kind of an icebreaker. I don't want you to think too hard about this, because that's really the point of it, is just a knee-jerk reaction. The first things that come to your mind when you hear the word saxophone, and there's no wrong answers here, it's no holds barred, go ahead and type them into the chat. Always jazz. What's interesting is New Orleans comes up every single time. Every single time. And it doesn't matter if it's, fifth graders, or if it's, master's degree, people with college education and master's degrees. It always comes up. So I think that's really telling. New Orleans is the birthplace of jazz music, and saxophone played a very important part in the evolution of that language as it was evolving. So I found it interesting that even the youngest kids in our public school system key into the fact that New Orleans and the saxophone are very closely related. So, any others? I love the Lisa Simpson one. A baritone sax player named Nick Brignola is the voice of Lisa Simpson on the Simpsons. And I love that, because The Simpsons was the longest running cartoon, sitcom, I think, ever at this point. And Lisa Simpson really brought the saxophone into the public eye, and brought along a lot of those stereotypes that come along with it too. Okay, great. So here's the guy who invented the instrument in 1846, Adolf Sax. So it was named after him. Not super creative. But the saxophone became very popular very quickly, immediately after its patenting. And its rise in popularity is tied to some really big shifts in global culture that were happening at the time. First off, we had public portable recorded music for the first time ever. Thomas Edison is credited with the earliest machine that we could play recordings on. In 1877, he invented the phonograph. Then there were some other versions like the gramophone and things like that that came later, but 1877 was the first available recorded music. Radio broadcasts came around right about 1906, was the first ever broadcast for music purposes, for entertainment purposes. And that can link to this engineering and technology wiki right here. There's an article here on December 1986, that's what happened. And it doesn't really say what they played, but it happened right about the time the saxophone was exploding in popularity. So we had women's suffrage, not only, of course, in the United States after the 19th Amendment in 1920, women were, the amendment states that the right to vote will not be denied to anybody based on their sex. This was actually a movement that was happening in a lot of different places in the world at the time too, though, which is bears mentioning, because it wasn't just a United States phenomenon. This was going on all over the place. And there's an interesting website here that's really cool. It's called Constitute, and it has the U.S. Constitution right here, so you can read all the amendments. And it's not just the United States Constitution, it's a compilation of constitutions from all over the world. So that's a resource that I found that I thought was really interesting, wanted to share with you today. Prohibition. We all know as Americans that, especially now, that if you prohibit something, Americans tend to do the exact opposite and show their independent spirit and their strong will. So prohibition didn't really work. It was a failed experiment. But with the rise of, or the invention of jazz music and speakeasies and all of these things coming together, it just furthered the popularity of the saxophone. And then we had two world wars that came along during the rise of the saxophone's popularity too. And we'll talk about how those really influenced different types of groups in society really strongly. So back to the instrument itself, Adolf Saxophone was born in 1814, and he was an instrument maker. His whole family was a family of instrument makers, actually. And his father invented a lot of really amazing prototypes for instruments. One of them was the bass clarinet. So we had a clarinet and they wanted to make it lower. So a mechanism that worked well technically for the symphony orchestra wasn't available at the time. So the sax family ended up creating the bass clarinet, which of course sort of became a precursor to what would be like a tenor saxophone type of situation. But he had three goals basically. First, he wanted to make money and he wanted to be an innovator. He wanted to change the world of instrument manufacturing completely. He wanted to turn it on its head. He wanted to replace all of the brass instruments in French military bands with saxophones. Because he thought that they were much better instrument. They were superior design. They were vastly superior to these brass instruments. They could do so much more. So he was really trying to fuse three instrument families into one instrument. And so here's what I like to ask people. What do brass instruments do really, really well? And can we...
They're loud, says Jim Anderson.
They're loud, yeah. They do loud really, really well. Exactly. And that's basically, I mean, they can be very subtle. They can play quietly in the hands of a master musician. Any instrument can have a range of dynamics, but you can't get as loud on a clarinet as you can on a trumpet. It's not possible. Cool. So what do woodwind instruments do really well?
I'm going to guess they play softly.
Yeah, they absolutely have a softer dynamic. But they do something else that brass instruments can't do as well. So if you compare, like, think about a trombone versus a saxophone. What can the saxophone do that a trombone can't do just based on the design?
Is it, like, hits very specific notes?
Yeah.
I'm totally guessing. Someone else help me out.
I love it. Woodwind instruments are great at playing quickly and technically. Yeah, because they've got lots of keys, right? And so we use our fingers to be very dexterous on the instrument. We can get around woodwind instruments. So woodwind instruments and string instruments also are known for like virtuosity. You know what I mean? String instruments have something that those other instruments don't have. In order to change pitch on a string instrument, you have to do something pretty specific. What do you have to do? You have to change the length of the string, right? And so the way you do that is you compress the string and then you move up or down. So it's not like one note and then another note. There's something in between the notes on a string instrument. And that's actually called sostenuto, and it's what happens in between one note to the next. And it's also, musicians refer to it as flexibility. So you can be flexible in your pitch really well with a string instrument. Saxophone can do all three. It's kind of like a conical clarinet made of brass, which gives it the loud part. It has the keywork of a woodwind, which gives it the virtuosity piece. And because of its conical bore, it can bend all over the place just with really subtle alterations in your tongue and your embouchure. So he really fused the characteristics of three instrument groups really well. And this up in the upper right-hand corner, is called an ophicleide. It's about the size of a Barry sax and it has a brass mouthpiece. So you would actually put a brass mouthpiece into this and buzz like you would a tuba. And this morphed into the diagrams that you see on the lower right-hand corner, which eventually became a saxophone. And I can tell you, because I've been a band director for a lot of years, that you can't just put a brass mouthpiece on a saxophone or a clarinet mouthpiece on a brass instrument and it works. It doesn't work. You can't change pitches. So he really did have to redesign the entire physical construction of the instrument and use those principles to make it work. All right, so he was really kind of put the cart ahead of the horse a lot, and he unveiled his instrument in 1844, which was 2 years before its patent came out. But he went to a trade show and he started showing people because he was so excited. So how could that be a problem? I ask kids this all the time and they're right on it, right? What's gonna happen if you don't have a patent and you bring something out into the open at a internationally prestigious trade show?
Someone's gonna steal your idea.
Yeah, absolutely. Or they're going to reject you outright and they're gonna come completely up against you for whatever reason, because it's their own interests financially or because they're just afraid of change. There's all these crazy legendary stories. I have no idea how true they are. I get a lot of them out of a book, which is really well cited, called The Devil's Horn, which you should check out. I'll find it and show it to you at the end. But it's by, I'll come up with it in just a minute. But anyway, there's legends like the saxophone was taken and kicked across the room. The prototype, someone, you know, one of his competitors was so angry that he destroyed the instrument. There were assassination attempts made on Adolf Sax. They came to his house. They burglarized his workshop. They blackmailed him. He went bankrupt over and over again in his life. And this doesn't even talk about his childhood. His childhood was riddled with accidents and all sorts of crazy things happened to this guy. They called him the ghost child in French because he was so accident prone that people didn't think he should be alive still. So a lot of, he really had a lot of adversity and he overcame that adversity. So in the United States, we, you know, like to think of having, you know, the New York Philharmonic is the best orchestra in the world, right? Or I would argue the Chicago Symphony Orchestra is the best orchestra in the world. I love the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. But you know, it's all subjective, right? But there were only two orchestras in the United States at the turn of the century. And they were both in New York. And only one of them really kind of outlasted the other. The New York Philharmonic is still around. But there were 10,000 community bands across the nation. And then in 10 years between 1890 and 1900, that number doubled to 20,000. And here's the guy that wrote The Devil's Horns, Sigel. It's a great book. You should really check it out. It's a really, really fun read. Lower left-hand corner, there is a book. It's a local author, Mr. Gary Gillette, who I really hoped would have come to this today. He wrote a beautiful little memoir and history of the Missoula City Band. And the Missoula City Band was founded in 1865, which is amazing. It's so early. They played on the courthouse lawn in that little gazebo thing, like that, not the same one, but that was the spot where the Missoula City Band played in 1865. They didn't have their first documented public performance until 1879. So it took them a while to get good, I guess. And there's even Missoulian articles from the founding of the city band where the band leader's like, we're working really hard to be good enough to actually present a concert to the public. So like, that's like 14 years. So it took them a while. But it just shows that the city community bands were so popular and the saxophone was rising in popularity. They were probably riddled with saxophone players. It was probably like a virus infesting our community bands all across the country. And in addition to that, there was an instrument manufacturing boom that was happening. So there were 1 million saxophones sold between 1915 and 1925 in the United States. All right, so let's get into some of the recordings. I've heard myself talk way too much. These are a couple of the very earliest performers on the saxophone. And when you hear these, think about like the context of like a major festival, like Bonnaroo or something like that, or, you know, a huge festival with multiple bands and whatever, and then the headliner would be like the Rolling Stones. These were the headliners. So that's the style that we were hearing at that time. The Six Brown Brothers played the entire family of saxophone instruments. There we go. And from the bass saxophone on the right all the way up to the alto, and they actually even played soprano instruments, which were even smaller. But as you can see, the person on the left is in blackface, and the other five are, you know, the other white dudes that are in the band. And it's amazing to look at this. It just vaudeville and minstrelsy at the turn of the century in the United States of America was wildly popular. It was the most popular form of entertainment for you know, white folks to go see people clowning around and making fun of black people's antics. So instantly the saxophone is associated with American racism and our long, deep history of racism. So Rudy Weedoft was a soloist. He was probably the first famous saxophone soloist. Like a Lady Gaga or a Madonna or a Prince. A solo artist.
Say, you're Rudy Weedoff, the famous saxophonist.
Discovered.
You're Benny Kruger.
Don't kid me, I know you.
Thanks, Rudy.
Say, listen, Rudy, I'd like to hear you play some of those very fast runs that you've made so famous.
Fast runs? Those fast ones.
Well, a Babe Ruth and all right. You know, they tell me you're quite a trickster on the saxophone.
Oh, thank you.
I say, what is your impression? He's got me doing it. Say, listen, Ben, play that little laugh that you open your program, your teeth program, you know.
The laugh? Right?
Yeah, sure, the program.
Think how it's done.
Let's both do that, what do you think?
Both of us?
Yeah, okay.
So Rudy Weedoft and Benny Kruger were treating the saxophone as kind of a novelty. You know, they were really slapstick about their approach to the instrument. And you saw Benny Kruger's imitation of Prohibition, which was essentially being drunk, right? So they're very famous people at the time, and they're portraying the saxophone in public as this slapstick novelty instrument. And that never leaves the reputation of the saxophone from that moment on. By the way, Bessie Mecklem was the first ever recorded, saxophone player in 1892 at the Edison factory. So it bears mentioning that the first ever recording on the instrument was a woman. And so we talk about marginalized social groups that were empowered by the instrument. I like to include children and students in our marginalized social groups category. A lot of times we don't talk to children as if they're real human beings. And especially when you think about public school settings at that time, you know, those kids were not necessarily treated very nicely. They were drawn to the saxophone, and they were drawn to their school band programs because it was something outside of that crazy environment of just very dry, you know, rigorous kind of discipline disciplinarian approach to public schooling. During the World Wars, women picked up the instrument in huge numbers. And there were all women banjo orchestras. There were all women saxophone bands. My Aunt Eileen from Illinois, she in the 1920s played in an all female banjo orchestra. So, you know, it was like 20 girls traveling around the country playing banjo. She was also a virtuosic pianist. You could ask her to play any song in the sort of American, you know, public or in the songbook, in the American songbook, you know, from show tunes. You could ask her to play anything on the piano and she would just sit down at the piano and orchestrate it out, accompanied with all the melodies in any key. It was amazing. And this this documentary is called The Women and the Girls in the Band. And it's really fun to watch because it shows all this vintage footage of these female orchestras. And then it goes on to interview the musicians now about their experience back then. And it's free, available on YouTube. You can check it out, The Girls in the Band. Just killing it. And then of course African Americans picked up the saxophone and they made it into a completely unique voice in jazz that really was completely unrelated with the Six Brown Brothers, to the Six Brown Brothers, to that Rudy Weedoff model, to that, like, the saxophone is sort of a parlor instrument. It's something that's played in your living room just like everybody would have a piano. They would have a C melody saxophone in all these, you know, middle-class white homes. That was a thing. African-Americans picked up the instrument and really defined the sound of it. So to the point that you can hear John Coltrane, or you can hear Cannonball Adderley, or any of these black jazz musicians, you can hear three notes and you know exactly who is playing. So we went up to do this presentation in Eureka. And we were sitting in the cafe there and having breakfast, and there were some yearbooks. And so we decided to look through them, and we happened to pull down the 1949 and 51, and we opened to this page. And it's the LCHS band, Lincoln County High School Band, 1949-1950. 14 of 22 members are women. There's an all female saxophone quartet, and the band leader, as you can see on the right-hand side, is a woman as well. So it was just a lucky strike. We found this and we were like, we have to put this in the presentation before we do it at Lincoln County High School today. So that was really, really fun to see. All right, so I'm gonna take you through a real quick history of jazz that is by no means complete. This is sort of a smattering of my favorite people going up, and also, you know, researching some of the most important voices in the music. There are thousands of them, but I've distilled it down to nine, I guess. Sidney Bechet, this guy up here in the upper left, he was a New Orleans saxophonist, one of the pioneers of the soprano saxophone. And this is a great video, not of Sidney Bechet's playing, but of some jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra players talking about the differences and the attributes of Bechet's playing versus like a clarinet sound. And I do this because a clarinet is designed as a cylindrical bore and the saxophone is conical. And the reason that's huge, that really gives the saxophone its unique character. If you don't know Jazz at Lincoln Center, it's probably like the biggest nonprofit that is supporting the traditional jazz in America right now. Wynton Marsalis is the CEO of it. Thank you.
things that I find you always bring, Evan, and I wonder if this is from your New Orleans training, is that singing tone. How do you get that? Well, and where does it come from?
I was thinking about Sidney Bechet and when we just played that little blues there. And Sidney Bechet, like a lot of the New Orleans clarinetists, always spoke about how they were surrounded by music. Brass bands in the street and the blues and French opera. And all of those things were in their playing. And the thing about New Orleans clarinet is that it gets to, unlike the clarinet in classical music, it gets to use vibrato. And Sidney Bechet himself used to love Enrico Caruso, for example, and loved opera. And I think he actually had a sound like an opera singer.
You know, one of the tunes that I try to introduce people with Sidney Bechet is Summertime. You know, he's got that famous recording.
Wonderful recording of Summertime, right. Well, that was special. He played that one on soprano saxophone. It has some different things that he would do with this. It's sometimes the clarinet can't take as much, you know, but the soprano saxophone can stand up to that attack. We'll keep thinking about Bechet.
So we got clarinet, saxophone.
Is that vibrato again? Sometimes you would quote opera.
So, the musicians in the Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra are some of the best traditional jazz players in the world. And they have an amazing education series out. They're always posting videos. They have band director trainings across the country. It's really cool organization. Sorry, here we go. Okay, and then saxophone started appearing in film, which also furthered the public perception of the instrument. This is from a movie called Body and Soul that's about the life of Lester Young.
Well, Lady Sweets, are you ready for tonight?
Stop it there. I'd like to put it to you guys for a second. How many jazz cliches did you see, or saxophone cliches did you see in that clip?
There's the cigarette.
Yeah, the cigarette.
And the, like, yeah, the smoky club.
Smoky club. It's the blue note. Any others?
a kind of the loner sax player in his hotel room.
Yes, right. What about the saxophone's gender?
Female.
Yeah, his saxophone's a woman, right? Do you remember the name? Lady Sweets. Okay. So, I mean, this is pretty strong imagery, right? Strong language, strong stuff coming out. Let me just talk real quick about this movie. Dexter Gordon was a saxophone player who came later, but he's playing Lester Young, who's a saxophone player who came a lot earlier. And Lester Young was a Kansas City saxophone player. Lester Young, like a lot of jazz musicians in the 1940s and 50s, experienced a disproportionate amount of racism when he was traveling and touring. And I mean, you can just continue to list off the black musicians that experienced these things. Duke Ellington's band, probably arguably the most famous orchestra, jazz orchestra in the world at the time. You know, when they toured the South, they had to park their bus in the back of restaurants and get off and use the colored toilets. And it was Duke Ellington. Miles Davis was beaten by police officers outside of his own venue. He was on set break. He went out to have a cigarette and police officers approached him and told him he couldn't loiter and he had to move along. And of course, Miles Davis is Miles Davis. I don't know if you have read about his personality, but he's certainly not going to back down to them. So he probably said something like, you know, this is my club, mother, you know, and then suddenly he was on the ground. So what a lot of jazz musicians at the time did is they looked toward Europe because Europeans were incredibly interested in the music. And the setting of Round Midnight is France, it's Paris. So that's part of Lester Young's life that's pretty cool in jazz history. He lived for many years in Paris and he was much more well-received and respected and highly regarded for his artistry by white people. I'm gonna skip the Charlie Parker and Coleman Hawkins because I'll just talk about it real quick. Charlie Parker was a musician who sort of really accelerated the music, not only in tempo, but in harmonic and melodic language. And he took it from being dance music, him and Dizzy Gillespie kind of pioneered this, to being much more like intellectual music that was for the concert stage. And he had incredible technique. I don't know, what time is it right now? How good are we on time? Do we have a little bit of time?
It's 4:35.
Okay. Yeah, let me play the Charlie Parker video real quick, because you can't talk about the saxophone and not check out Charlie Parker. No video on this one, I guess. This is Coleman Hawkins. You listen. Listen for his vibrato. So he has that old style of playing that's really vocal, like we talked about with Sidney Bechet, where they're using vibrato and it's really flexible. And then you move along, here's birds playing.
He plays like four times as many notes.
Yeah, at least. Yeah, so the legend says that Charlie Parker he went to a jam session and played poorly and they booed him off the stage. The drummer it was Papa Joe Jones, famous drummer, took his cymbal off of his cymbal stand and threw it across the stage at Charlie Parker while he was soloing. and it gonged him out of the jam session. So it hit the stage and crashed, and everybody stopped playing, and Charlie Parker had to leave the club with his tail between his legs. And he went, and after that spent 2 years in a woodshed up in the Ozarks. And he spent 2 years learning every single note that Lester Young played, and then playing it twice as fast, double timing it. And he learned every note that Lester Young played, and then he invented his own language and went on to pioneer it. So, but he was called Bird because that stands for yard bird, and he loved to eat fried chicken. All right, let's see. I keep skipping, I'm sorry. Okay, so then John Coltrane came along and really took the instrument to a new level of like intellectual artistry. And you can see how they started to portray jazz musicians on the concert stage post swing dance band era. It became much more of a concert music. No video? Can you guys see the video? No. I'm gonna skip that one then. I'll just say that John Coltrane is in a tuxedo with a black bow tie. There's a spot on him on the stage, and the production on the video is really amazing. There's multiple cameras and multiple angles, and it just portrays John Coltrane on the stage as sort of this god. Okay, and then there were many people who came along and decided to commercialize the instrument. As jazz musicians were sort of trying to intellectualize it, other musicians were coming in and trying to commercialize it. And one player that you probably will all recommend is this, or recognize, is this this guy Boots Randolph. It's the old Yakety Yak song. And the saxophone in rock and roll was treated more like an electric guitar. You know, it wasn't about the complexity, the increasing complexity and multiple chord changes and all these things. It was really about like I'm losing all my video on my safe share things. I don't know why. Sorry. So imagine a middle-aged white man, really clean cut looking with glasses, playing that to a completely white audience, all clapping along. And it's the take out the papers and the trash. Don't, and you don't get no spending cash. Just a wildly popular early rock and roll song, or rock and roll song, maybe not early, but sort of this boogaloo saxophone style started coming about. And then let's see, I wanna make sure. This was the actual predecessor of Boots Randolph. And this is probably the earliest player who used the saxophone in like the honking and screeching kind of paradigm where we think of saxophones today as being kind of abrasive. Okay, I'm gonna go to a plan B here for a second. Because you have to see this iconic image with Jay McNeely.
When I was a kid, we would go to a Shady Lane roller rink in Kalispell.
Yep.
And they had that Stand By Me soundtrack that played Yakety Yak all the time. That's how I used to hear that. Uh-huh. That's the association.
I mean, everybody knows that song. I played that solo when I was in sixth grade. My band director's like, play the Yakety Sax solo. I was like, that's the coolest saxophone solo I've ever heard. You know? So, let's see. Big J. Here it is. So you can look at this iconic image.
Pop torpedo, Bill. Dig that cat. He's famous.
So in the same way that John Coltrane was getting horrible negative reviews for and Project Barker for playing too many notes and over-intellectualizing the music, these people were getting horribly negative reviews for doing the exact opposite. But you can see that the audiences didn't care. They thought it was incredible and they went crazy for these kind of antics. Really overly simplified and like really, really riff-based and that real growly, raspy tone were the kind of hallmarks of this rock and roll saxophone style. And you can see this black musician here laying on the ground playing solo, Jay McNeely, and he's whipping this white audience into a frenzy. All right, and then Junior Walker came along, and then I really hope this video comes up because Kenny G became sort of the first saxophonist to make music videos. Wildly popular with the saxophone as the main voice. I mean, no lyrics, nothing, just solo saxophone music videos. And just take a look at again, we're looking at stereotypes, we're looking at meme material. So there's Kenny G, and now we've moved from the movie with Dexter Gordon to kind of into this more modern presentation of saxophone on video. What are some of the modern stereotypes that you're seeing now that the saxophone represents?
Well, isn't it still kind of the guy who's a loner? I mean, isn't that sort of a holdover?
Yep, it is definitely a holdover. Absolutely, it's always been a solo instrument.
Right.
I love the image of the saxophone with the seagulls on the beach. I mean, who walks down the beach with seagulls and plays the saxophone? Nobody does that. It's not a thing, okay? You know, he's got a white shirt with suspenders. He's got a perm. There's a cover of a Kenny G record that we used to give out as a joke at my old undergraduate school where he's wearing nothing but white denim. I mean, this guy really has a visual persona, okay? And then his sound, and he has like 1,000 Christmas albums probably. His sound is not the real sound of a saxophone. It's so electronically processed. It's like almost beyond recognition. He is hands down, single-handedly, the most commercially successful saxophonist who has ever lived. Kenny G has made more money than any other saxophonist in the history of the world. So who's heard of the sexy sax man? Anybody? Okay. Now, since memes have become a thing, this guy has come along. And I just want you to look at the Kenny G video and look at the Sexy Sax Man video and observe the similarities. So this is what people think the saxophone is. This is what kids, like, there are hundreds, thousands of middle school band students who, including my fifth grade student from St. Joe's Elementary, who showed up to her last lesson, is like, check out the song I learned, Mr. Dwyer. And they're learning the George Michael saxophone solo because of Sexy Sax Man. He's taking these stereotypes and he's just like putting them out into everybody's view. He's plastering people with them, you know? So this movie, let's go back to the 1960s. I just want you to notice the soundtrack of the movie, which really kind of weasels its way into your subconscious. And I tried to find the most sort of primary iconic clips that I could possibly find for this presentation. But again, there's thousands of movies with saxophone soundtracks.
Down there and go to bed.
Yes, I want my clothes out here.
You shut up. You're gonna get the law on you.
Stella!
You gotta beat that woman and then call her back because she ain't gonna come. You're gonna have a baby.
Listen,
I'll
listen.
Say haul you in and turn a file.
Yes, I want my clothes down here.
You stink.
Hey, Stella!
So this was really risque for the time, right? And you've got all kinds of things happening in this scene. It's a really kind of a dark scene, right? So what does the saxophone represent in this scene is my question, I guess.
Sex.
Yes, absolutely. But more, there's more, right?
That longing.
That longing and there's that, even though they're fighting, even though it's a horrible relationship, the saxophone is like, it's like the enabler, you know, or something. Like she's just sort of acquiesced, right? So it's connecting it with all these lowly qualities in society. The Pink Panther is another extremely famous saxophone melody. And let's see what the saxophone represents in the Pink Panther, or just what the Pink Panther represents. So in this movie, in this instance, the saxophone is about crime. And in this instance, the saxophone is about crime. Taxi Driver has a nonstop saxophone solo soundtrack through the entire movie. It's just one long saxophone soliloquy. And if you haven't seen Taxi Driver, it's also a very dark movie. He's so upset with what he sees driving around in the nightlife, he kind of goes vigilante at the end. And this melody plays the entire movie. Like Cybill Shepherd, the little sexy kind of connection that they have between the driver and the passenger there. So all of these movies are just reinforcing the saxophone's association with sex, with crime, you know, with violence, with being a joke instrument, being a novelty instrument. It's been portrayed like this through its entire history. However, it does have an art music side. And it always has. Going back to the Paris Conservatory, the gentleman on the left is Jean-Marie Landex. He was the first professor at the Paris Conservatory, which is the most famous classical saxophone school in the world. Marcel Mule is the second guy who also taught at the Paris Conservatory. And then now in modern times, we have people like Timothy McAllister teaching really new music, very avant-garde, very experimental music that pushes the boundaries of the technical abilities of the saxophone. Okay, so I'm gonna bring in art now, and I know I have zero time, so if people need to leave, we're almost at the very end. But John Zorn is a Pulitzer Prize winner, or I'm sorry, a MacArthur fellow, who plays the saxophone in a way that you might find surprising. And there have been between 30 and 40 MacArthur fellowships awarded in saxophone over the last half of a century. From John Coltrane to Steve Lacy to all these people, John Zorn, it's really been a voice. So this is John Zorn and Masada. So what's happening in this music?
It's just chaos and screaming.
Is it chaos?
It sounds like it.
Or is it purposeful and directed?
Well, it's maybe purposeful chaos. it's maybe expressing the feelings of chaos and anger.
Uh-huh. How does it make you feel, Sam?
What?
How does it make you feel?
Very uncomfortable.
Yeah. I asked Sam specifically because I knew the answer to that question. Maybe we can each just really just summarize. How does the Masada clip make you feel? To me, I'm just like fascinated. I'm stopped in my tracks and I just have to watch it. It's like I'm drawn in because it's like nothing I've seen before. And I'm sort of aghast at it.
And it's sort of... Go ahead.
It does feel like an assault.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's stressful.
Yeah, very, very high tension music.
And you it's know, like there's an intentional connection to history with Masada. And the
event
place up there, right? That's really fascinating.
Yeah. So what, you know, and it's interesting to hear kids' responses to that question with John Zorn. You know, it's all over the map. Some kids really dig it because they have a lot of angst, you know, and they kind of relate to it, I think. But however you feel about it, I think one thing that we can agree on is that John Zorn plays the saxophone unlike anybody else plays the saxophone, which is why he's been recognized for his artistry. And, you know, he plays all sorts of different types of things, but one really great recording is Naked City. And Kim, Wayne Horvitz is on that. album. Wayne Horvitz worked with John Zorn. He actually name drops John Zorn a lot because John Zorn went on to become really, really famous, and Wayne is the pianist on Naked City. And it has the most amazing version of the James Bond theme I've ever seen. So really worth checking out. So there have also been Pulitzer Prizes awarded to lots of saxophone players as well. So, you know, we can look at art, we can look at music in a lot of different ways. We can look at these paintings that kids, like when they're there and they're too painted to
it's
what
like
you've heard.
Kenny G on the left and John Zorn on the right.
Boom, that's like the most clear synopsis you can get, right? But how are they similar?
Color.
Yeah.
You know the color.
They share the color scheme. I always bring this, I haven't had some, I see depth in both paintings. I can go backwards into each of these paintings, whether that's purposeful or not, but, you know, and then another example is two Picassos back to back. These have different emotional, you know, they affect us differently emotionally. Based on our experiences and based on who we are and based on our preferences. And I think that's a lot like the saxophone as well. So thank you so much for having me. I hope you've gleaned some new perspectives about the saxophone. I'll just describe the picture in this slide. These are the series of Con Naked Lady saxophones that they came out with. And on the bells for a number of years, they engraved the naked torso of a woman on the saxophone. So it's just everywhere in the history of the instrument, this association with, you know, the saxophone is a woman, the saxophone represents sex and crime and all these negative parts of society. And it has this really reputation as being sort of the redheaded stepchild of the woodwind family. But it also has another side that really is very progressive and pushes the boundary of human thought and human artistry. So you either hate it or you love it, and you can decide for yourself. Thanks, guys.
Thank
is
you. Thank you
question?
All for being
can
here.
A question?
Cheers.
Oh, yeah, I'm here for however long we can talk. I'll nerd out about the saxophone for hours.
Okay, and this is more about the kind of jazz writ large, but I mean certainly the saxophone as well.
Yeah.
So in the far recesses of my memory back in grad school, I read a book called Red and Hot, and it was about jazz in the Soviet Union, right?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a really interesting book. And my question is, what is it about, so we've talked about sex and we've talked about crime, but what is it about jazz and maybe the saxophone that it's also associated with rebellion? I mean, this idea that people want to break. Yeah, what is that? They drove it underground in the Soviet period because it was just a little too chaotic, I guess. But and also
the Italian fascists banned the instrument. Hitler banned the instrument. The Catholic Church banned the instrument.
Side of it?
I have a theory that it's the youngest one. It's only 174 years old. It hasn't been, you know, it's so young that it's open. It's like up for grabs, you know, when it was first invented. And that's kind of the point of this whole presentation with all those things happening at the same time. It was sort of like a perfect storm for the saxophone to just leap into the public consciousness. And it's that individuality that you can bring to the instrument because of its design and because of its flexibility. And I would say that the rebellion part goes with like prohibition, and it goes with jazz, and it goes with African Americans playing the instrument. And then, you know, a bunch of white people picking it up and copying African Americans playing the instrument and doing that thing. And, you know, white people taking their own direction with it, you know, and there's always been conflict around the instrument. So I think the instrument, because of its young nature and because it was adopted in the way it was by who it was, I think that's what lends its rebellious nature. Not to mention just, you know, the associations we have with it, right? From film and from media. that have just been pounded in our, into our brains.
It's kind of transgressive.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, have a great weekend, everybody. Thank you for coming. I appreciate it.
Thank you. This was great.
Awesome. I appreciate it.